Apple released macOS 26 Tahoe this week, and among the many big changes, one tiny little one caught my attention. You can now remotely unlock FileVault disks via SSH. So that's what we're going to dig into in today's video. But before we do, did you know that we've just launched a brand new Discord server over at discord.gg/tailscale? Come over there to find me at AlexKTZ and tell me what you're using your Mac for as a server. Now, in today's video, we are going to test this remote unlocking, and I even found a way to shove Tailscale into this video, because if you want to use this to remotely unlock your Mac, well, it's not running the full user space tools yet, so we have to use the Tailscale Subnet Routing feature. So in the typical Mac boot process, if you have FileVault enabled, the system does a few things. Firstly, it turns on and does what's called, I guess, a post, or at least that's what we call it in PC land. Anyway, I don't know what Apple call it, but basically that's the point in time where the Mac checks all of its hardware is in order and it can continue with the boot process and it has a boot volume that is ready to go. Secondly, it then tries to boot into an OS proper. But if you use disk encryption and the system can't load the OS until you decrypt the drive by entering your password, you end up in a bit of a catch-22 situation, because there are no user space services running at that point. So no Tailscale, no full SSH daemon, no Rust desk, no way to remotely unlock that disk unless you walk over to the terminal of that computer and type the password in on the keyboard. Once you've done that though, once you've typed that password in, the OS will continue to boot and automatically log you into the desktop. And this happens so fast on modern Macs that I'm sure many of you didn't even think about that. When you type your password in, you actually just watched your computer cold boot and log you in to your user session all at once. Now, this is all fine when we're dealing with macOS that's on a laptop on your desk in front of you, it's right there in front of you, because you have all the stages of the boot process laid bare for you to see. But what about if it's a Mac Mini or some other Mac system that you want to leave running 24/7, as maybe a local LLM host or a Plex Media server or a Rune Core instance? Well, as of this week with macOS Tahoe, we can now unlock the remote FireVault disk encrypted disks via SSH. Now, there is still no wake on LAN support, at least as far as I know, for macOS. Please tell me I'm wrong down below, because that's probably the final piece of this jigsaw for remote server administration. But this really has leveled up or completely removed a problem that has plagued those of us trying to use Apple hardware as small, power efficient little servers. Now, how do we set this up? It's actually pretty straightforward. So if we go into System Preferences, they renamed it System Settings. we want to then look for the Sharing menu. So let's just type that in here. Next, we want to go to Remote Login. Check that box. And that's it. That's all you have to do. Technically, I found that I had to actually go and do a successful SSH connection one time before I rebooted, and then it worked. So what would we do here? I'm going to show you how this actually works on a real host. I have a Mac Studio downstairs, which is on 10.42.7.213, and I have enabled remote access. So I can do SSH Alex at the IP address of that remote computer, type in my password, and I'm running on a Mac, right? Let me see if I've got fast fetch on there. I do. Okay, so it's a Mac Studio, M2 Max, running macOS. It's been up for 12 hours. Great. I am going to reboot that computer now, and it has FileVault turned on. So you'll see that now if I do 10.42.7.213, yeah, it's going to do the reboot process, and then I'm going to sort of SSH into this kind of small pre-boot SSH server. It's this dedicated tiny little SSH server that runs in the pre-boot phase before any of the user space services actually come up. Now, with the ping, we can see that the reboot is happening slowly but surely. It's shut the Mac Studio down now, and I guess it's doing that kind of post phase that I talked about, where it's checking all the hardware still exists and kind of spinning up that micro SSH server in the pre-boot phase. And there we go, it's at the pre-boot phase now. So if I do the same thing again, ssh alex@10.42.7.213. Notice this. The system is locked. To unlock it, use a local account name and password. So I literally just type in the same password that I would type in at my desk downstairs. And you'll see that the pings drop out for a second or two whilst it boots, because the pre-boot SSH server terminates, and then we end up in a user space SSH server instead. So I'm now going to do Tailscale ping Mac Studio, because, well, there we go. It's already booted. It does happen fast. Essentially, we've just done it right there in video in real time. We've rebooted a Mac and unlocked the FileVault disk via SSH. And so that's all you have to do. In the sharing menu, just enable remote login. Make sure you SSH into your host one time. I think so. It like generates a bunch of like pre-shared keys and the node and host key and stuff like that that SSH uses. You can't use things like SSH keys, like your public-private key pair that you would normally use. You have to enter the password, because that's what's unlocking the physical disk. So a couple of caveats, but nothing too difficult to set up, I don't think. Remote login, and you'll be good to go. Now, I did promise you that you can do this remotely from your phone. So let's run a ping to start with. This is going to be going through a subnet router that I have in my network. And I've got a video about subnet routers up here. But essentially, the concept is this. You are in a remote network and you want to connect to a device in this network that can't run Tailscale. In this case, the Mac Studio isn't running Tailscale because the user space services haven't started yet. And so what we need to do is have a device somewhere else in the network that can reach the Mac Studio on the local network, because it's not running the Tailscale client, so it can't do all of the NAT traversal magic that Tailscale normally does. So you can see here, I've got a ping running, and let me do this, and I will do SSH Alex at 7.213, which is the Mac Studio downstairs. Fast fetch just to prove that. Yep, so now we'll do sudo reboot, and we will see in the pings up above that the Mac Studio is now going to reboot. So what I want to do is make sure that I'm connected to Tailscale on my phone, first of all. So I'm going to open up the Tailscale app on my phone, make sure that I'm logged into the same tailnet as the subnet router in this network. So this phone is on 5G, so effectively this is simulating that it could be anywhere in the world. It's not on this physical network, it's outside of the firewall here. So in order to reach the 10.42 subnet, you would have to either open a port in your firewall, which you definitely don't want to do for SSH, or use a Tailscale subnet router, which will run on an Apple TV or a Raspberry Pi or indeed any other headless system. Now, what we want to do is verify that I can reach the Raspberry Pi. I'm going to press and hold on the Raspberry Pi and press ping. This is going to establish, or at least try to establish, a direct connection from my phone here over my cellular provider back to the Raspberry Pi. It's actually running on the bench just over there. But in order for this phone to talk to it, it has to go out over T-Mobile through their network, and then in through AT&T, and then in through their network, and then it's a whole thing. Anyway, we're establishing a direct connection in 50 to 100 milliseconds from my phone here, does all that magic, and ends up on the rack over there. So we have a way into my network from the outside. What we now need to do is use this app called Blink. This is an iOS shell app. It gives me a terminal, makes me feel like a real hacker. Now, remember, this phone is outside the network. I'm going to try and ping 7.213, and we can see that we do indeed get a ping. Fantastic. So I will now do SSH and then use my Mac username of Alex at that IP address. It's going to ask me for my password, which I will dutifully enter. This is the same one that I would enter at the physical keyboard in person. And you can see, you may now use SSH to authenticate normally. The system was successfully unlocked. So, hypothetical scenario that I create for these videos, I'm out and about and I need to get into my Mac remotely or whatever. I can now do that from my phone and unlock the disk, as you know. Now, if I SSH again to that same IP address, it's going to once again ask me for my password, which I will again enter. But this time, it's logging me into the full user space session with all of my tools available, like Tailscale, like FastFetch, like Rust Desk, all of this stuff, right? And it's magic. And that's how you do it remotely. Now, in order to set up a subnet router, it's quite a straightforward process. You want to make sure that you've got a Raspberry Pi, for example. So I'm going to do Zafod at Raspberry Pi, because that's the username I set on my Raspberry Pi. And then I'm going to want to do sudo tailscale set, and then dash dash advertise routes equals, and then the subnet that I want to expose. So in my case, that subnet is 10.42.0.0/21, which means there's like 6,000 or 7,000 IP addresses available in this house for me to use for all sorts of nonsense. Yours will probably look something like 192.168.1.0/24. And you would find that out by going to IPA on the Raspberry Pi or whatever device you're running, and basically look for your DHCP range that your router's advertising. And you can see here that my Raspberry Pi is running in the 192.168 range. So yours will probably look something like that. I happen to have two subnets going on here. I don't wish to confuse you, but I've got one VLAN on the 192.168 subnet that I usually use for these videos. And then my Mac Studio is on my private subnet that I normally don't show on camera in the 10.42 subnet range. I appreciate that is overcomplicating the Pi today and probably not needed, but essentially what you want to do is tailscale set dash dash advertise routes equals, and then whatever subnet your Mac Studio or Mac Mini or whatever Mac that you're trying to unlock remotely lives in. And once you've done that, you have to go to the Tailscale admin console in your browser. The reason for that is that we don't normally allow people to publish routes without manually checking a box, just a security, really, to make sure that you are who you say you are. So if I want to go to edit route settings, and then if I uncheck this, I have to make sure that these boxes are checked, essentially. So I have to make sure that the subnets that I want to be advertised remotely are allowed to be forwarded through the Raspberry Pi, so that when those packets come in from the outside, they then get passed on to the correct destination. So that's really a very quick overview. Like I say, I'll put links to documentation about subnet routers and links to videos and cards and all that kind of stuff throughout, peppered throughout this video, because it's a fairly straightforward topic once you get a head around it. But I'm aware that the first time you do it, it's like you have to rewire a couple of neurons. So it can take a beat. And like I say, there are videos up there and links in the description that should help you out. And broadly speaking, I think that's pretty much all you need to know. Just a reminder that in the pre-boot phase, there isn't a full typical SSH server running. No user space services, so things like Tailscale and Rust Desk and all the stuff you'd use to normally remotely access a Mac won't work. But that's okay, because with the subnet router that I just showed you, we can tell Tailscale to publish a route to your client devices that says, hey, if you try to make a request or a connection to this range of IPs or this IP in this specific subnet, then you should probably try and send those packets via that subnet router over there. And then those packets will appear as if they originated from the subnet router, in my case, the Raspberry Pi. And the real beauty of this is that the subnet router can be something as simple as an Apple TV or a Raspberry Pi. In fact, I have a video about Apple TVs and subnet routing up here. Now, you can get subscribed to the channel for a bunch more videos about CI/CD and Tailscale and how you can connect all of your different devices together. And as always, you can go over to tailscale.com to get started today for free. We offer 100 devices and 3 users for free on our free plan that we've committed will be free forever. As always, thank you so much for watching. And until next time, I've been Alex from Tailscale.